have the opportunity to worship our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And as I stood there worshiping, I said, Lord, hear the saints singing. But one day we'll be seeing you face to face. What a glorious day. And those of us who, in whose hearts that hope has diminished, God has sent his word for us today. So that we will not pass up the glorious invitation to be with him in eternity. For this life passes. For this life passes. Whether you believe it or not, it passes. And this is preparation for the hereafter. Let us pray. Wonderful Father, we thank you, Lord, for your word. For your word, O God, is the lamp that guides our feet, the light that shines our path. We thank you, Father, for your spirit that dwells in us, that uses your word, O Lord, to guide us. And so, Father, today, as you have sent your word, knowing that what we have need of, I pray that by your spirit that every heart here would be receptive, O Lord, to what is being spoken. And that, O God, you would turn away our eyes from the things, Lord, that have distracted us from your calling. And turn us to you, O Lord. Turn us to you this day, we pray. Open hearts, open minds. Inspire us once again. For the words you speak, they are spirit and they are life. And we receive it with thanksgiving. And give you all honor, give you all glory, and give you all praise. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah. Today we are in the book of Hebrews. Hebrews chapters 1, 2, 3. And if you push me, we will go to 4. Hebrews chapter 1, and I am reading from the King James Version. If you have a different version, it would read differently, so I think the scripture will come up on the board. So let's read the first four verses in Hebrews chapter 1. God, who at sundry times and in divers manners spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom he had appointed heir of all things, to whom also, by whom also he has made the world. The wills, who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high, being made so much better than the angels, as he hath by inheritance obtained a more excellent name than they. Let's run to chapter 2. Let's do the first four verses again. Remember what we read in chapter 1, that God, who in time past spake through prophets, in these last days spoke to no, by no one else but his Son. Chapter 2 says, therefore, because God has chosen to speak to us by Jesus. Because God has found it important, very important, to speak to us through his Son, the writer of the book of Hebrews said, therefore, we ought to give the more earnest heed to the things which we have heard, lest at any time we should let them slip. For if the word spoken by angels was steadfast, and every transgression and disobedience received a just recompense of reward, how shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation, which at the first began to be spoken by the Lord and was confirmed unto us by them that heard him, God also bearing them witness, both with signs and wonders and with divers miracles and gifts of the Holy Ghost, according to his own will. Let's run to chapter 3. And we would read from verse 7. Wherefore, as the Holy Ghost saith, today if you will hear his voice, harden not your hearts as in the provocation in the day of temptation in the wilderness, when your fathers tempted me, proved me, and saw my works 40 years. Wherefore I was grieved with that generation and said, they do always err in their heart, and they have not known my ways. So I swear in my wrath, they shall not enter into my rest. Verse 12. Take heed, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. But exhort one another daily, while it is called today, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. For we are made partakers of Christ if we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast unto the end. Today's message is on steadfastness. Being steadfast. Steadfastness is one of the most important Christian virtues or characteristics or quality that anyone can develop. Steadfastness. I know you would say, but Brother Glenroy, love is very important. I would say, yes, it is. Brother Glenroy, faith is important because you can't please God without it. I will say, yes, it is. But I want to say to you that it would avail us very little if we are loving today and not loving tomorrow. It will avail us very little if we are on fire today and dead tomorrow. Come on. So if we, I would like to say, as it was said in the Proverbs, get wisdom, get understanding, get knowledge, but with all you're getting, get understanding. So get love. Get faithfulness, get zeal, but get steadfastness. Because it would not avail anything. Amen? I don't think that's that hard. How many of us have seen people start a race and they go on out front? And you say, surely he winning. And when you reach down by the finish line, he ain't rich. Steadfastness comes from the word stead, which means place. And the reason why I say that, it seems simple. I know you know what steadfast means. But I want to emphasize this. That's why I'm breaking up the definition. So being steadfast means being in your place, keeping your place. Amen? That's the point we want to make. Steadfast is being devoted or loyal to a person, belief, or cause. It means being firmly fixed in place, immovable, not changing. The purpose of the message today is therefore to ensure that as Christians we remain stable and devoted to Christ in this dark and changing world. Saints of God, brethren, we live in a world that is changing, changeable. You had an iPhone today, this Mother's Day. By next Mother's Day, it changed. You want to change. Why? Come on. We know we live in a changing world. But it's also a dark world. A world that gropes, if it were, after the truth, it would be good, but they grope and they do not know what they grope after. God has called us out of that darkness, and we need to continue steadfast unto his glory. As Christians, we must be firmly rooted and grounded and established in our faith. Get one yes, two amen. Let's see if I repeat that again. I wish, you know, that we all will say amen, if you agree. As Christians, we need to be firmly rooted, grounded, and established in our faith. Yes. Amen. Your life in Christ depends on it. Your eternity depends on it. Your success depends on it. Get two amen. Your success depends on it. Why I say that is because we believe what the world tells us. We believe the success of the world. It is attractive. It is nice. And so we go after it. But it lies in the end. It lies in the end. It doesn't lie in the beginning. In the end, it lies. But if we remain steadfast, if we remain constant, if we remain fixed in our faith, we will be successful in our lives. I'm not talking to people when they hear success, they see one set of money. And if they ain't see that, there ain't no success. But I want to commend to us. You know, David said, I was young, now I'm old. And I've never seen the righteous forsaken. I've never seen his seed begging bread. David said that. I could say like David, concerning this. I was young, now I'm old. I have never seen any achievement in this life that is more admirable than one who knows Christ. Amen. Never. And if that doesn't resonate in your spirit, It's because the achievements of this world mean more to you. But remember, I say, in the end it lies. For what good it is when you're on your deathbed to have achieved all. That, for instance, the founder of Apple Company, Steve Jobs, achieved all, built it all. So many of us use his invention. You should read his final words. What does it matter? What does it matter that you get an iPhone? It is very important, saints of God. I haven't come to know Christ, having come to know him, that we come to the realization of what he truly represents to us and in our lives, so that we will not tinker with our salvation and that we will not be easily swayed. We will be steadfast. For as we read in our text, the last verse I read, which is verse 17, I think, of chapter 3, that we are made partakers of Christ. If we hold fast our confidence unto the end. Many begin in Christianity. Many begin in Christ. Many started off loving the Lord. Many sadly turn away. Many here today may be in danger of turning away if we do not heed a word like this today and strengthen those things according to our Lord that are ready to die in our spiritual lives. Our Lord knows exactly what we need to hear. So that we would strengthen the feeble hands. What did he say? Lift up the feeble hands and the knees that bow down. And continue steadfast. If we are to remain grounded, we want to revisit again what it is we want to be grounded to. Or we need to remain grounded too. We need to revisit again the contents of our salvation. We need to revisit again what it is we have received. We need to hear again the gospel of our salvation. We need to hear it again. It is our foundation upon which our faith is built, to which we are to be fixed, and to which we are to remain steadfast. For other foundation can no man lay than that which is laid, but Christ Jesus. There is not another gospel, saints. This is it. There is not another Savior. Jesus is in. There is no one else that can deliver. God is the way, the truth, and the life. Despite what the world tells you, despite what Satan lies to us concerning, there is no other way. And God is faithful. Hallelujah. Somebody say hallelujah. Because it's him we serve. And it's good to know you are serving a faithful man. Amen?
Yes.
Amen?
Yes.
If we were serving someone who, when we look for them tomorrow, we don't know where to find them, then we have some problem. But as we sing a song, you are precious. The rarest of treasure, but yet so easy to find. You find God difficult too? The word of God said, draw near to me, and I will draw near to you. Is God far from you? Try drawing near. Just try drawing near. You'll find he's right here. Find it bouncing up on him. Yes. I can say so. I can tell you there are times when I wake up and I say, Father, you're so far. You know, you go through these dry spells. And then the Spirit said, praise him. Praise him. Yes. And by the time I start praising him, I said, wait, the Lord. You're right here. Yes. He's faithful. Yes. Not in my notes, and I can't testify this morning or I wouldn't finish. But God is faithful. Yes. Somebody say with me, faithful.
Faithful.
Hallelujah. He will not let you down. Yes. Give him a hand of praise. If you tell yourself or anyone else tells you that God will let you down, run from yourself and then run from them. God will not let you down. I don't want to get ahead of a message. All right. I had you read one set of scripture, more scripture than you read for the week. That's all. You wonder, Brother Glenn, what was all this reading of the scripture about? All right. We read Hebrews 1, verses 1 to 4. In these verses, the scripture spells out, and remember what I'm doing here, is revisiting our foundation, revisiting our faith. I'm preaching to you again the gospel of salvation that you have been received. Amen? Amen. In these verses, the scripture spells out clearly the established dominion. Now, listen to these words. They are words you know. But the Lord placed them in my spirit in a particular order to have a particular effect so that it will impact you how the Lord wants it to. So when we read that God who has sundry times, etc., in this scripture, it spells out clearly the established dominion, the established authority, the established power of Jesus Christ. My God, that's a whole message here. We could take up the offering if you get that and go home early and eat. If you get that, you see, when you say the established dominion, what you're saying, nobody else has dominion over him. Nobody else has any dominion. What did he say in Revelation when he went to John? I who have the keys of death and hell, I who shut and no man. Come on. Amen. I who shut and no man.
Open.
And conversely, it's true. I who open and no man.
Shut.
So if we are saved, if we serve a Savior that has dominion over all and he opens up opportunity for us, who it is to stop it?
Jesus.
Who? Remember, I just told you that this is important for our success. This is important for our success. Jesus is. So what was done here by the writer in the first four verses in chapter 1? He established who Jesus Christ is. It confirms Jesus as the Alpha and the Omega, meaning those two letters, the first and last of the Greek alphabet, the first and the last. It established Jesus Christ as the beginning of the creation of God. It establishes him by as his son. This is what the writer of Hebrew started off doing. Hebrew is a beautiful book to read. I hope by reading those three verses, actually I wanted to go to the fourth one, but I wouldn't have time. The fourth chapter. But it's beautiful. And I like the way that the writer approached it. He first established the authority of Christ. If the authority of Christ is established in our heart, then we should be looking nowhere else. We should be going nowhere else. We should be having no doubts. Amen?
Amen?
So the very first principle we want to do to be steadfast is to establish in our hearts the authority of Jesus Christ. Give him praise and glory. Jesus Christ, who stood before Pontius Pilate and never answered when Pilate asked him anything, except when Pilate got a little fast and tell him, you don't realize I have power to save you, or I have power to kill you. What Jesus answered and told him? He said, Mr. Pilate, you have no power over me except my Father give you. Hallelujah. And that is so for you and I, a child of God. No one has any authority unless God give them. Or unless you give them, as we sometimes give the devil authority to interfere in our business. Yeah? And even so, in the case of Job, Job was a perfect and upright man. He didn't give the devil no opportunity. Who gave the devil opportunity over Job? And you saw the end of Job? Amen. So the very first thing we want to be establish, if we are to be steadfast as Christians, is who we are steadfast to, who we are to be loyal to, and who is he? Let us look at Christ again. Look at it again. I know you figure you know it. You know it since communion, and you know it since first and second communion, you know it since Sunday school. But there is need now, as we face the vicissitudes of life, as we see situations happen to us, problems in our health, problems in our relationship, situations and circumstances we find ourselves in, there is need to ask ourselves, Lord, are you yet in charge? Like Jehoshaphat, go up to him with the letter and he said, Lord, we have no might against these foes, but our eyes are on you. For we do not know what to do. There are times when we don't know what to do. And that is the time when our faith slips, when we move away. But we want to establish again the authority, the dominion, and the power of Jesus Christ. For he is the one to whom we have to hearken, pay attention. Now, in those four verses, they didn't call him a prophet. And I want to throw this in here because I know that I'm not only talking to us here, I'm talking to many by live stream, and many who would hear or receive a recording of this message. We see, and I look at television often, and I look at this teacher of Islam, a slim guy, he's a medical doctor. He talks English with a funny accent. Not making fun of him, just can't remember the guy's name. But he was explaining to a young woman in one of their congregations, was explaining why Muhammad is the final prophet. And I mention this because in Islam, they teach Jesus, but they teach him as just a prophet. Remember, I'm talking about us being steadfast in faith and holding on to that which was established, for there is no other foundation. And he was saying that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, as they say. He's the Prince of Peace, but they say peace be upon him. He said, Jesus Christ said in John 14, he acknowledged, this is what Islam is saying, that there was someone else to come when he said he would send another comforter. Yes, I saw it. And I wanted to jump on the television and say, no, no. He wasn't talking about another one single person, because it was clear. He said he will be in you. You know, if Jesus said that he was supposed to come, the other person was supposed to come, you could probably buy their argument. But Jesus said this person is in you. Now, which person that will come that could be in you if it were not the Holy Spirit? But this is what Islam uses. So they refer to our Lord. They refer to the founder, the author, and finisher of our faith as a prophet. And I'm here to say he is not no prophet. And even if we choose to call him a prophet, then he is a prophet of all prophets, just as he is the King of all kings and he's the Lord of all lords. And, you know, this particular guy, I like to listen to him. Whenever he answers a question, he ends by saying, hope I answered the question. And he goes and sits down. He answered the question. Well, when he said he hoped he answered the question, I said, he didn't answer the question. But that is just a side. So this is why I had you read verses 1 to 4 of chapter 1. The rest of the chapter, the author was merely just talking and reinforcing what he said about Jesus and the angels. Because there are a lot of people who had to talk about the angels and angels and angels. And what he was saying that we had to listen to the Son. In chapter 2, the first four verses, he continued on the revelation of the supremacy and the authenticity of Jesus. What Jesus has said and what Jesus has done, that's what he continued doing. He continued to caution and to warn us more strictly against carelessness or callousness in our faith and in our response to him. When he said, therefore you ought to give the more earnest heed to the things which you have heard, lest at any time you should let them slip. This is what he said. And he used an example of the Israelites in chapter 3. So that's why I had you read it. Because we are speaking to steadfastness. And we want to know, well, listen, things are changing in the world. I have said so. And many Christians would like an easy gospel. Let me put it so, you know. This faith thing, and I had to pray and wait. I just want to download an app, you understand? And I save. You know, I find this too hard. You should just, if God love me, I should go to him, Father, BMW, look at here. Or you replace whatever you want for BMW. And a lot of Christians have a problem with it. Having to wait, having to be continuous, having to be steadfast. They have a problem with that. And as a result, we tend to fall away from that which we believe. So up comes on the scene, maybe the evangelical scene, and a fella come up with a new notion. Listen, all you have to do is sow a seed. You see all them trouble you have? Sow a seed. Well, everybody have seed in their pocket. Those who don't have seed, taking other people's seed to sell. Why? We want it easy. But you know, there's a scripture that says, don't remove the ancient landmarks. Just listen to that scripture alone and it will tell you. The things that we have begun with are the things that we would continue with. For God is unchangeable. He is the same today, the same tomorrow, and forever. He's unchangeable. His ways are unchangeable. And he is faithful. So if anybody, Paul put it this way, if anybody came and preached to you, or if we preach to you another gospel than that which we have preached, let us be accursed. Yes. Paul was so emphatic that you cannot change this. Amen. This is it. This is the infallible truth. This is it, what we have given to you. This is life. Yes. Hallelujah. Yes. We are establishing what we began with, so that we could continue steadfast. That's the purpose. We are preaching again the gospel of salvation to us. The good news that said that we were born in sin. I know somewhere along the line, a lot of us forget that we are sinners. Or that we were sinners. Somehow we think that we are good, you know. Yeah, I'm a good person. I'm not like Brother Glenn and them, you know. I hear Brother Glenn's testimony. Me do what he do. So you see why I had a tongue and love Jesus? Because if it was you, I wasn't getting salvation. I would have been waiting. You'd have probably had me, it's Jacob who served for 7 years to get his wife. And after that, he gave me the wrong woman. You had to go another 7 years. Yes. One writer said our minds are like leaky vessels. They don't, without much care, retain what we put into them. That's why the writer of Hebrews says we ought to give the more earnest heed. This is not a careless thing. Don't believe. Many times we come here. When I finish sweat, you go outside and forget what I say. You know? If I get a joke, you get a joke. No, I'm serious. Many times, well, I don't know what pastor. Pastor more anointing than me. I just had a sweat. No, pastor, you ever see pastors? Pastors preaching, he dry, he jacket dry. When I when I finish, all of me wet. And I have half the anointing. No, serious. And yet with all of that, we gone outside and we leave with angel wings. We forget what we hear. The word of God says we ought to give the more earnest heed. We need to, because this is it. I don't know if I could stress it anymore or sweat over it anymore. This is it. The faith with which we have begun in Christ. This is it. This is the glory. Brother Glenn, that is the glory. Yes, this is it. You see what happened? I know you are seeing more glamorous things. But you and I know that all that glitter is not gold. You know, there are so many examples. If I go to give them, I would just stay giving one set of examples. And think you have gotten that point. So we ought to take heed. We have to understand we tend to forget. We have to understand that this happens to us, maybe through the fall. Maybe this is how our minds are corrupted. Maybe this is the seed of evil that is in us. That we forget the things that are right, that are true. What we began with, we began because we know it was right. Amen. Amen. I will say it again. What we began with in Christ, we began because we know it to be right. Amen. Okay, when did it start getting wrong? If it was right, how come it changed? What changed it? The circumstances at the time, because we have been in the wilderness. But we have the example. We have the example that our Lord, having delivered the people from the children of Israel out of bondage of Egypt, he passed them through the wilderness. He left them in the world, so to say. Before he promised them a land full of milk and honey. He promised them that. He said, listen, I'm taking you there because I have a covenant to take you there. I told it to Abraham. And listen, I'm faithful to my word. I'm going to take you there. But I want to pass you through a little wilderness. So because we are being passed through a wilderness, it means we were not delivered from Egypt. That we desire to go back to Egypt and to be in bondage to sin? Hold on. Throughout this message, you will hear me saying that there are other attractive alternatives. Hold on. There are people who could probably be right now on their boats or on a golf course or in some luxury circumstance. Do you know how to come and say, Jesus saved? But this is it. Yes. You see, there will come a time when your boat will fail. Yes. There will come a time when your luxurious situation will cease being luxurious. Yes. And if the situation will change, your body will change. You will have no more desire. And you will be facing death. Yes. You will be facing the inevitable. You're going to be facing that which you knew you were going to face one day. Since you came into the world, you're going to die. But when they have you sling up in the hospital, you're hoping that you don't die. You ain't ready. And at that time, your heart is so hard to yield to Jesus. So remember I said, in the end, it lies. It speaks flowing things now. It speaks glowing things now to us. But in the end, it lies. There are a lot of young people who are listening to this message today. Take heed. The word of God said childhood and youth are vanity. And you're more susceptible to the temptations of the things of this world. They are for young women or for young men. There are members of the opposite sex who their heart is not on God. They have nice car. They have well-toned muscles. And they would present an attractive alternative to the little brother in church who you know. Who love you so bad. But your eye fixed, like Samson, your eye fixed on Delilah. Remember, all that glitter is not gold. Yes, the fella glittering. I ain't saying he's not glittering. The chain wrong in there glittering. He might have gold teeth in his mouth and that glittering and all. There's a calypso. Years ago, a calypso near sang it. Take heed, my children. Take heed, my children. Have a fella called Lucifer. A bag of white powder. And you don't want a powder, no face. That is what sin does. Yes. So we reestablishing what God has enlightened us from. We no longer in the dark, so why are we going back there? Yes. Amen. I know I'm preaching good and you're watching me. I will say all my amen. Because what we do after we have heard the word, we go back and allow the enemy to snatch it away from our minds. But God is calling us to faithfulness. So that is the first two pieces of scripture that I read. We have established that there's no one else but Jesus. There's no supremacy. He's loving. You can't fathom his love. You know, you want to know, they say his love is greater than the ocean. I don't know how great the ocean is. Maybe you know, right? But I know if you dive into his love, as you dive into an ocean, the more you swim is the more water, the more love. That's Jesus Christ. The Lord is gracious. The Lord is good. The Lord is slow to anger. The Lord is merciful. He is plenteous of mercy. And he has called you and I. He has called you and I. We didn't call him. Jesus said it. I have chosen you. You haven't chosen me. So what I'm trying to establish to us is someone who has bountiful love for you. Someone who has loved you with an everlasting love. Someone who paid an awesome price for you. He has called you. And he has a purpose for you. Is to him you are required to be steadfast. Well, why wouldn't you? You know, if Donald Trump, anyway, let me leave that alone. But, and if Donald Trump calls some young lady here, you understand? My pastor, Donald Trump called me. Anyway, let me leave that alone, right? You see, what happened to us, and this is what God in his wisdom does. He reveals to us his glory and the inheritance. Although he's written in his word, he reveals it in our spirit. Is in our relationship with him, our worship of him, that this thing come as a reality. If you come just so and you sit down and you read this thing prayerlessly, I had to do 4 verses for the day. Well, I make my 4 verse, I could go now. If that is the way you come to the word of the Lord, you wouldn't see. But if you sit prayerfully before the Holy Spirit, and you ask him to open up, Lord, show me. Show me what this majesty is all about. Do you think there is a throne? Do you think there is a dominion? Do you think there is a glory in this world to be compared with that Jesus Christ is or has for us? If you think so, think again. But how would you see it if you and I keep only seeing the things that are in the world? That's all in front of me. That's all in front of me. So we realize now what we need to do. We need to diminish the things that are in front of us. Amen?
Amen.
Yeah. In other words, magnify Jesus. That's how we magnify him. Put him more in front of us. Okay? Now, he said we ought to give the more earnest heed, lest we let them slip. For how will we escape if we neglect so great a salvation. We sin against the gospel. It's a neglect of our salvation. The gospel holds not only the promise in this life, but the promise hereafter. And I'll keep saying it, God is faithful. It's not me. It's not Pastor Banfield who's saying this to you. It's Jesus telling you that he is faithful. And I'm saying by the Spirit of God to you to remind you that Jesus is faithful and he who had called you. Amen. So if we neglect his salvation, it is a contempt of the saving grace of God. What do you say? It's like Esau who despises birthright. That's all. We don't want to do that. Because he sought it afterwards, though. He went crying to get it back. But brother Jacob, he's not smart. He get that. He not going to let him have it again. He couldn't find it. And the word of God cautioned us. If we neglect our salvation, we make light of it. We don't find it important enough. And this is what we say sometimes by our attendance in church, our attitude to church. Take, for instance, we worship here. You have been coming faithfully here. But you take no part in the ministries. Why? Is God not working here? Is this not the work of the Lord? We sit under a pastor who has raised this ministry up, who has worked assiduously to make sure that no flesh come and stand up here but Jesus. To make sure that no man is lifted up here. Do you see people lifted up and flaunt themselves before your eye? Or don't you see the word of God unadulteratedly coming before you? What is the example that is before you? Then is God not working here? If he's working here, why aren't you more involved? I know you say, Brother Glenda, I don't neglect. Yes, you neglect. Well, Brother Glenda, everybody can't do everything. Do what you could do. Do you understand what I'm saying? Yeah. Let me tell you something. A lot of people say, well, I want to see miracle. I don't see no miracle and no power and no Holy Ghost. Hold on. Let me go back to the scripture and read it, because sometimes we just read a little too fast. Come here and read verse 4 of chapter 2 of Hebrews. Put it up on the board, please. Chapter 2, verse 4. God also bearing them witness, both with signs and wonders and with divers miracles and gifts of the Holy Ghost. What the next phrase said? God is the one who performs miracles. Amen?
Yes.
Not so?
Yes.
And he's a good God. Not so?
Yes.
God will perform a miracle if a miracle needs to be performed. Amen?
Yes.
Amen? Amen?
Yes.
You need a miracle to see it, to believe Jesus Christ is Son of God? God knows that you know that. So what he's showing you miracle for? Mean to show you that could do a miracle? God in the Trinidad, you know. God is flim-flam, you know. You want to see a miracle? Well, tell me what you want to see a miracle for. If miracles would make you a strong Christian, God will do it every day, you know. It will not. Let me tell you something. If you go back to Egypt, in the land of Egypt, it's about 11 miracles or 10 God had to wrought mightily on Pharaoh to change the heart, you know. So why am I speaking this? There are those who are vainly puffed up in our own minds, thinking that the church is not effective, and the church is not doing this, and church is not doing... We wouldn't say we no longer love the Lord. We wouldn't say our heart is going back to the things of the world. No, we want to blame something in the church. We want to see Holy Ghost and people falling down. And when they fall down, they get up walking crooked. No, listen. God is the one who performs miracles, gifts, and signs according to his own pleasure. Well, take it up with God. No, you go take it up with the pastor. You go take it up with Brother Glenn. There are a lot of people who come, the attitude at the altar. Well, pray for me now. Well, pray. Pray anything. Just pray. You is the one who holy. You is the one who preach. So you should pray and help me. That is people's attitude. You would think it is funny.
But that's how some people are.
They do not come with faith. But we know that when we call upon God, that he hears us. We have the confidence. For we pray not according to our will, but according to the will of God. And because he hears us, we know that we have the petition that we ask him for. Because we ask it according to his will. That is the word of God. I didn't want to preach this morning. I believe me. But I don't know why the Spirit is preaching this on me. Because this is why many are not steadfast. Satan put in your mind, blame the church. They don't like how Sister Jenny's singing. What does that have to do with Jesus? No, Satan will put anything in your mind. Need you to go away from the work that God has raised up, exemplary before you. But instead of you casting a lot and say, Lord, let me, I see these people serving you. Wait, are you, okay, we're not serving God? I ask you a question. We not serving God? Well, come and help me serve God now. Eh? No. Let me leave that. Right? So in this way, we neglect our salvation. And we don't think it is a neglect, but it is a neglect. You find a place looking clean? Look around. Look around by your foot. You see any sticky paper? If you see, pick it up. People volunteer to clean it where you were. Why? Because they volunteer to clean the house of the Lord. They start from the humblest. No, you want to tell the preacher, the pastor, you can preach. So the pastor must come and give you to preach. And let me leave this. What I'm saying is that there are ways, very subtle ways, which we neglect our salvation. Oh, my laptop. If this is good, then I shouldn't be preaching like that. If this is good, why aren't we sold out with it? What, I want to stay here. I know it doesn't have a note, but somehow the spirit will stay. If it is good, why are you not doing more in it? Or you're not seeing Jesus? You see, this is what happens. Is what happens. The whole Jewish nation miss him. You know why? Came like a baby in a manger. Miss him. You see, they wanted to see Jesus, the king, who will take over from the Romans and tell Pilate and them where to get off. Jesus came, swaddling clothes, no place to lie. Isn't that an example of your Christianity? That's what our faith is. It seemed today that we are nothing. It seemed, well, yeah, they say I'm a child of God, but why are you suffering? Well, me and Ona, I ain't believe this, no? I find I should be better off. But the word comes to you all the time. That's how God has packaged your salvation. That's what you must work out. He said, work out. Didn't the word of God say so? Your salvation. I've given it to you. Just as what he told Joshua. Every foot of ground you step on, I give you. So what happened if Joshua didn't step on it? Then he again? It's the same as our salvation. This is the way God has ordained or determined to identify those who love him. You're coming for bread and fish, Brother Kenneth? Is bread and fish alone you're coming for? You see somebody fall along here and they get up and America perform. That what you're coming for? You're coming for me. And that is why the word of God is quick. It's powerful. Sharper than any two-edged sword. It pierces to the dividing asunder of the joints and the marrow. And is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. What is in your heart? Are you neglecting your salvation? If you do, you will fall away. You will fall away. You know, you might even fall away now, May 5th. June 5th. No, you may not fall away June 5th. Wait till July 5th happens. They can't see you. Okay, maybe not so quick. Are you going to be here? Well, none of us will be here, so we may not talk about that. But I think you get the point. The message is so that you would be steadfast. We know what's steadfast. You would be fixed. I cannot be fixed. Listen, if pastor called me to preach, Well, boy, I find all them little holes all in the seat to fix. So I had to do something for the Lord. Do you understand? Yes. But I will not be saved. I will not have received the gospel of salvation. I will not have seen my life gloriously transformed from the wretched sinner that I was. And now sit down home watching TV, eating popcorn. Woo! Woe is it to me. I have to be involved. It's my salvation. I have to make sure that those who have been holding up the flag has enough strength to hold up the flag. Those who have been fighting in the trenches, they have strength. They have strength. I want to come alongside them. I want to be with the saints. They are praising God. I want to be a part of that. I want the praise to be glorious. And when I come, I'm going to open up my big mouth. You know why I'm going to open up my mouth? Because I want the praise to be glorious. I don't want Satan to say the place lukewarm. It's going to be hot. That's how I want it. I'm telling you that you have to do exactly like me. My mouth big, I know. Right? But what I'm saying, judge your own heart. With what zeal and with what enthusiasm you praise God. And why not, having received so great a salvation? Or do you neglect it? Let me leave out that point. I didn't read Hebrews 2:10. But I want to read it now. Hebrews 2:10. For it became him, for whom are all things and by whom are all things, in bringing many sons to glory, to make the captain of their salvation perfect through suffering. Verse 11. For both he that sanctified and they who are sanctified are all one. For which cause he's not ashamed to call them brethren. Why did I read that verse? I'm revisiting again your salvation. And I want to ask the question. Are you sanctified in Christ Jesus? If you are, say amen. Some are so sure. Well, let me explain to you. If you have received Christ Jesus the Lord, you are sanctified by him. You just read in verse 11, for both he that sanctifieth and he and they who are sanctified are one. Jesus Christ sanctifies the church by his own blood, by his spirit. We are sanctified. You didn't know that. Or you think you had to reach a place and then get sanctification. No, true, we go on from glory to glory to glory. But Jesus Christ has sanctified us. He has purchased through his blood. He has purchased through the cross. That is why it is said the cross is his highest glory. Jesus has purchased the right of the Holy Spirit to give it unto those who follow him. He took it from the Father. He said so. Go to John. And he would give it to us. That is how we will be part of him. That is why Paul could say in Romans 8, if any man hath not the Spirit of Christ, he's none of his. This is what differentiates Christianity from the rest of religion. This is about a relationship with God. This is not about a set of things that we are reading only, but it is the work of the Holy Spirit in our hearts. And I will say to us now, that if none of you, if any of you, do not have the confidence that you have the Holy Spirit, then you need to receive the Holy Spirit. We had a baptism of the Holy Spirit class, and we had a wonderful reception. The Holy Spirit is yours to receive. You cannot be a Christian without receiving the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the one that will convince you of the sin. Maybe you have the Holy Spirit, but what happened? You probably find yourself doing something wrong. You want the Holy Spirit to obey for you? No, the Holy Spirit would not obey for you. When you're going to do that wrong, he's screaming, no, no, no! And then you tell him, shut up. That is his work. When the word of God is ministered to you, it is the Holy Spirit that is confirming it in your heart. It is not what I say. It is not my diction. It is not my intellect. It is not my sweat. It is not my anointing. It is the work of the Holy Spirit of God. The words that we speak, they are spirit and they are life. And they come to you because of the Holy Spirit. Jesus Christ said the world can't receive him. You see, to receive the Holy Spirit, you have to first receive Jesus. Amen. Haven't you received Jesus?
Yes.
Be steadfast now in him, for you have been sanctified by him. The Holy Spirit is sanctified as the Spirit of Christ. All true believers are sanctified. They are endowed with holy principles and powers. And they are set apart for holy purposes. That's who you are. Christ and believers are all one in the Heavenly Father, who is God. All true believers are brought into relationship with Christ through his Holy Spirit and are one with him. 1 Corinthians 6:17 said, "But he that is joined to the Lord is one spirit." Oh, you never thought so. Let me see the hands of all those who know they are saved. Let me see your hands. Do you know you are one with Jesus? One spirit? Okay, if you never knew that, go to 1 Corinthians 6:17. Mark it, hold it down, tear it out, put it in your pocket, and say it every day. Why? It will change your whole perspective of your relationship with him. You are not now trying to get something he has already given you. Well, Brother Glenn, well, why do I struggle? I'll come into that. That brings us to chapter 3, and we read from verses 7 to 14. When he talked about the Israelites, how they do and they will not enter into his rest. So having concluded chapter 2, and he concluded it with this. We didn't read the end of chapter 2. But having concluded chapter 2 with the declaration that Jesus Christ is able to succor all that are tempted, having himself suffered for us and like us. So you and I are being tempted. You and I are under trials. Yes, we are. And I'm not denying that. And that is simply what it is. But Jesus Christ, who has begun your faith, the word of God says that he is able to succor all those who are tempted, having suffered like them. So he knows your suffering. So you and I are not suffering alone. He knows the disappointment. He knows the hurts. He knows the anguish. He knows the fears. But he comes to us saying, "Fear not, I have overcome the world." We sang the song. He has overcome. Why do we rejoice? Because Jesus overcome. Because we are in him and we too will overcome. As we heard on Friday night, and we hear almost every Friday night, that we are more than conquerors through Christ. This is the gospel to which we must hold fast and be steadfast and continue steadfast. We just revisiting it. And after finish the day, you have to answer yourself, do you want to remain steadfast? That's why I'm revisiting it. That's why I'm saying all of these points. This is the same gospel you've heard, not another gospel. Now, join an example from the children of Israel, the people of God under the old covenant, who, having been delivered from the bondage and the oppression of the Egyptians and destined for the promised land, they failed to make it because of their unbelief. He cautions us in Hebrews 3, which is our key text, to take heed and be steadfast. This caution is twofold. When he said in verses 12 and 13 and 14, "Take heed, brethren, lest there be in you." Now he's writing to believers. He's writing to those who go to church. This text is for those of us who believe in Jesus. So he's saying to us, be careful, lest something is found in us. Just as how iniquity was found in Lucifer, who was a covering cherub, as we read in the book of Ezekiel. Iniquity was found in him. We as Christians could find ourselves with an evil heart. Come on, help me, please. Say evil heart. We could find ourselves with an evil heart. And that will make us depart from God. The caution is twofold, against an evil heart of unbelief. And the other caution is that we be hardened, or we be not hardened, through the deceitfulness of sin. What is an evil heart? How does an evil heart come about? Well, there are many ways for it to do so. But let me say this, that if we are careful and we do not neglect our salvation, but do those things that are needful to preserve our salvation, We would guard ourselves against an evil heart. But Brother Glenn, I ain't telling me much. You know. Oh, okay, let me get it. You're going up on Facebook for 8 hours. Yeah. And it's only gossip and looking at all kind of weird things and all kind of things. And no time for no Bible, no Holy Ghost. You find out all that Brother Glenroy do. Oh, God, I was on Brother Glenroy face. Is it? Face page? What do you call it? I don't even have one. What? Profile. Not a profile, a page, or whatever it's called. I don't know. What they have? And Brother Glenroy get a new grant. And whole day is only commerce and people business. How did your spirit have any time to grow? Hold on. We have an enemy. We have an adversary. He watching into our camp, you know. He know what we had for lunch. So he know you can't run no 400 meters with 2 Crick biscuit. You understand? Yes. You see, this is spiritual, saints of God. This is spiritual. You are a child of God. But instead of involving yourself, delighting yourself in Christ, you spend more time in the other things. It means that your spirit man now become famished. You know what famished means? Weak. So the next temptation come, you fall. And then you go and tell the pastor, Pastor, sorry, I don't know how. How you mean you don't know how? How you mean you don't know how? So this is what I'm saying. There are many ways. I just use Facebook. I don't know what else to use. In your job, those of us in business, and I'm in business, the world give us an evil mentality to regard business as business and church as church. How many of us know that? Don't pop your hand, Pastor. What you mean? It's an evil mentality. Business is business, you know. I had to make money. Who tell you how to make money? Who tell you how to make money? Don't you know something? You have to suffer loss in business? No, you don't suffer loss. Look, I have a business friend there. I can ask him to stand up. You know how many times you have to go through loss in business? Sat one day with managing director, very prominent fellow in Trinidad. He sat down when he started his business. He was joking. You're saying, well, if somebody only go in a parlor now and buy one bar of chocolate, he go see his graph going up. What do you mean? Sales so flat that if somebody buy one bar, he will know. Today he's one of the biggest confectionery distributor in the Caribbean. I know the years when he was not making. A lot of us forget that. What I'm saying here is that we tend to separate as Christians our business life from our church life. So when we go out there, we do all kind of things to people. If we are contractor and they pay us half, well, them to catch. Yes. Listen, I don't say this with any gladness in heart, but it is sad how some Christians treat you in business. And if anybody have had that experience with me, oh God, forgive me, I repent. I repent, you hear me? Are you forgive me? Because I may have erred too. But it's the same. We serve the Lord Jesus, whether in business or whether in church. Where I am, he is with me. I am his temple. That is why if I defile his temple, he will destroy me. I know many of us have defiled the temple and we ain't see he cut us down yet with no bolt of lightning. We are in the gospel dispensation of grace. And God may not do it as how we would do it with Achan and open up the ground. But what he does, you would receive a rebuke in your spirit. You would know it. You receive dryness or leanness in your soul. You cannot understand why. Why you're not experiencing the Lord? Why? Because you have acted in disobedience and you have been disobedient to the spirit, right? And you want to make money. So he sends leanness into your soul. You're getting money, yes. Bank account, nice, right? Overdraft. Gone down, and you're so lean, and you fall into many foolishness. It happens, and if it hasn't happened yet to you, be guarded against it. Stay close to the Lord. Let him be your guide in business. He knows business. What do you think Jesus know about business? Listen, Jesus take two loaf, Pastor. Five loaf and two fish. How much people eat? You think Jesus don't know what business? Didn't he say one will chase how much? And ten, and two will chase what? The world will say two will chase 2,000. Jesus going to 10. Do you understand how he is far superior in everything that he does? Because he's the creator of all things. So let's not lead two lives. We lead in two lives. Let's not do it. We don't have to do it. What we have is what we need to guide. That we need to do, continue steadfast. An evil heart of unbelief. Plenty of people, they make professions of Christianity. They're zealous for the service of God. And after time, they're gone. They're dead. They have no staying power. We live in a world that is unsettled. There is what? Artificial intelligence. We go on the net, we read all kind of things, and we feel we know. Go on reading books on this and books on that, and we find, well, all rivers lead to the same sea. And we start to get our faith corrupted, and then we see nothing wrong with this and nothing wrong with that, right? That's how the enemy comes. You turn your eye away from that which you ought to. The antidote for that is given by Moses to the children of Israel, or given by God to the children of Israel, that you must talk with him in the way. When you sit down, you must talk with him. When you get up, you must talk with him. You must write it around your neck. Put it on your door. As you get up, we talk about Donald Trump and who's the other fellow? We spend more time. And I'm saying this to make you realize that we need to cultivate that which he has deposited in us, the holy seed. If we do not cultivate it, it would die. Like this, the seed that was sown among rocky grounds, on rocky ground. It had no depth of earth, so it died. Steadfast. When we draw closer to God, we grow our roots. The roots are important to store and to nurture. As Christians, we are to grow roots in Jesus Christ. We are to grow. If we are to continue steadfast. Because we lack steadfastness, we become lukewarm. And Jesus said, you're neither hot nor cold, I will spew you out of my mouth. Yeah, we here today and not here tomorrow. Sometimes we okay, sometimes we not okay. We come to serve Lord when we want. We have not committed ourselves to prayer. Commit yourself. One of the most glorious things to be in the company of the Lord and asking him. Worship him and bringing your petition before him, knowing that he loves you and he's faithful. But we will not do it. The enemy has kept us away from it. And as a result, we become famished. As a result, we can't be steady. And then 1 minute, we waver. We want this, we don't want that. We're not so sure about this. Look in your heart now and answer the question. How many things you're not so sure about? You're not so sure. You don't know. You don't need to know all the things you want to know. You need to know. You don't know about tomorrow. You know to know who holds tomorrow. That's it. There are many things, there are many questions that I can answer. But I don't bother with that. Because what I can't take care of, he didn't allow me to know to take care of it. Get up this morning. I had to bathe and brush my teeth and so on. That I know. That I do. Go on by the table and the wife had nothing to eat. That I don't know. In closing, let me say this. I believe that you agree and understand and accept the word that we need to be steadfast. Could I have an amen?
Amen.
I believe that having heard the word, you will commit yourself to being steadfast. Let me have an amen.
Amen.
Just remember that Paul, having preached again the gospel in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, ended by saying, in verse 58, "Therefore, my brethren, be strong, be unmovable." I have it in my notes. I'm trying to quote it. "Therefore, my brethren, be steadfast. Be unmovable. Don't let anything move you." The word of God said there will come a falling away. The falling away don't have to be to you. "Always abounding in the work of the Lord, which is the work of love and faith." Be steadfast in faith. Be steadfast in love. Be steadfast in prayer. And be steadfast in hope. As much as we know that the labor, our efforts will not go unrewarded. Our efforts are not in vain in the Lord. May we stand, please. Hallelujah. Praise God. Thank you. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, that you know exactly what we have need of. And so we thank you for the word that you have sent to us today, urging us, O God, to be steadfast. For eye had not seen, nor ear heard, nor had it entered the heart of man what you have in store for those who love you. By your Spirit, you reveal that to us, wonderful Father. So I pray for every hand lifted up here, Lord, that you would find us faithful to the end. We commit ourselves this day, Lord, to be steadfast in faith, steadfastly loving you, Lord, steadfastly looking unto your kingdom, steadfastly, O God, working that which you would have us do. I pray, wonderful Father, that as you have sent your word, you will turn the eyes of your people away, O God, from the weak and the beggarly elements of this life. We'll turn away our eyes from beholding the vanity that distracts us, O Lord. And that you will, by your grace, O God, so pour your Spirit upon us, so strengthen us in our spirit man, that our zeal, O God, will be increased, that, Lord, our running in the latter would be even be stronger than when we first began. That we will continue to run, O God, with zeal, teaching, O God, in our homes, teaching, O God, our children, O God, in exhorting one another as fellow believers, exhorting husbands, exhorting wives, that we, O God, will be sold out for you, Lord. We know, Lord, that we have a tempter, but we thank you, Lord, that you have promised and you are faithful, that we will not, O God, have more than we are able to bear. And so we thank you for the grace to endure the trials and the temptation. Let your will be done in our lives, Lord. Let your Spirit rise mightily in us, O God. And let your glory be seen in everything that we do, as you find us faithful, that we would hear the end. Well done, my good and faithful servant. We thank you, we bless you, and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah. Before I go, today you will have heard the word if you're here and you're not saved. You are here and you have not given your life to Jesus. If you die now, you'll go to a lost eternity. For it is appointed unto man once to die. I was once like you, but today I'm no longer like that. I'm a saint of God, saved and sanctified, as you heard, by Jesus Christ. You too can be saved and sanctified. You too can be a child of God. But it's a prayer way. I would like to lead you in that prayer. If you're here today and you would like to make Jesus Christ the Lord of your life, I would like to lead you in a prayer, but I need to know who you are. You lift your hand up and say, "Preacher, pray for me. I would like to receive Jesus." Yes, ma'am, I see your hand, one in the front. There's another gentleman behind. There's two. Is there another one? There's someone under the balcony. Three. Is there any other? It is not about numbers. It is a day and it is a call. The word of God said today, if you will hear his voice, harden not your heart. Today, Jesus Christ is speaking as your Savior. He's calling you to be your Lord, to save you. He wants to make your life successful. He wants to make you, he wants to take away all that the enemy has put on you. Today, would you accept him? Would you join these three that have put up their hands? Is there going to be another? Is there going to be in the balcony? There's one young man. Yes, sir, I see your hand. The word of God says, suffer not the little children to come unto me. So, yes, ma'am. Is there another that's going to join them and say, yes, I want to receive Jesus as my Lord and Savior? Just remember that if you refuse or reject, this call is a rejection of Jesus Christ in your life. If you have not raised your hand and you would like to still, as the three people I invite, come to me, please. As you come to the altar, I will lead you in a prayer. You can join them. Is still open. Is there going to be one more? All right. This is simple yet profound. The Word of God says that if you will believe in your heart the Lord Jesus and you will confess with your mouth that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with the heart you believe. In your heart you believe. But it is with the mouth that confession is made unto salvation. So it's both a heart thing, you're believing, and the fact that you have come to the altar today indicates what is in your heart. But I would lead you in a prayer which will tantamount to your confessing. And on the confession of the words of God, God will wrought his miracle of salvation in your life. It is by spirit, it is by his spirit that you would be reborn today a child of God. So bow your heads, close your eyes, do not be distracted. You are not praying to me, you're praying to God. Say these words out loud and mean it in your heart. Dear God in heaven, I come to you today. A sinner, for your word says that all have sinned and come short of your glory. I believe with all my heart that you, Jesus, left heaven's glory, you came to earth, and you died for me. I believe with all my heart that you rose from the dead. And I now accept you, Jesus, as my Savior. And I confess you as my Lord. Lord Jesus, forgive me of all my sins. Come into my heart. Put your Holy Spirit in me. And teach me to live for you. By faith, I receive you into my heart, Lord Jesus, and I thank you for saving me. Amen. It is by faith that we receive from God. You have confessed your sins before God. You have accepted the salvation through Jesus Christ. And you have asked Him to put His Spirit in you. You are born again of the Spirit of God. You are standing here, not the same person who came before the altar. You are now in Christ. Why? Because the Spirit of Christ has entered you. To have the experience of the Spirit of Christ, there are people teach who are standing behind you, who will take you into the Word of God and show you what you have received. They will explain to you. They'd make an appointment with you. It's not to join the church. It is to give you the understanding of how God has begun to work in your life. Amen? I want you to keep the appointment. I want you to grow and be steadfast in Jesus. Amen? Thank you. God bless you.